listening to BostonFreeRadio.com.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the show Words on Film, the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke, and you are listening to the show either on BostonFreeRadio.com or watching it on SCATV, that's Somerville Community Access TV, located here in our fair city of Somerville, Massachusetts, or on Facebook Live, either on my personal Facebook page or on Boston Free Radio's Facebook page. Either way, I'm glad you could join me. We've got a lot of Oscar news to talk about. Not only am I going to be talking about the Oscar results and what I thought of them, including what happened at the very end of the night, but also I'm going to be talking about the Razzies. That's the other fun award show that unfortunately is not broadcast as far as I know. If some streaming channel like Netflix or Hulu wanted to pick up the Razzies, I absolutely think they should. I've been advocating this for years, but maybe next year. Meanwhile, before I get to the Oscar results and what I thought about them, here's what's topping the box office. The top 10 box office results of this past weekend. So what I'm really surprised about is that the Lego Batman movie is no longer number one at the box office. It's been knocked off the top spot after 3 weeks. Now, the movie that's number one, I'm actually very surprised is number one. I was really eager to see this movie. I did see it, and I'm going to be reviewing it for you next week. But what I'm really surprised is that I thought maybe it'd be kind of one of those fringe movies that would probably be number five at the box office if I was lucky. But lo and behold, it's number one at the box office. That movie is Get Out, directed by Jordan Peele, of all people. It's kind of a horror film, sort of mystery suspense, although, as you'd expect from Jordan Peele, it actually is pretty funny in some parts. But I'll get to my review next week. This weekend, Get Out made an astounding $33.4 million in the United States. And I don't have the international numbers for you, but its budget is $4.5 million. So in just one weekend, Get Out not only hit the top spot, but it also made more than eight times as much as it cost to make. That's incredible. So Get Out is, in the United States, a certified hit. And around the world, it would be a certified hit, but I have no idea how it did in other countries besides the United States. But even though the Lego Batman movie is not number one at the box office anymore, it's number two this week, and it's probably not suffering at all. The Lego Batman movie made $19.2 million at the box office this weekend. Against a budget of $80 million, the Lego Batman movie has made so far $133.2 million here in the United States, and $226.2 million around the world, which makes it a tentative hit here in the States, if you can believe that. But it's a certified hit all around the world, and all around the world also includes the United States. John Wick Chapter 2 was number four at the box office last weekend. This weekend, surprisingly, it climbed to number three, having made $9.4 million this weekend in the United States. Against a budget of $40 million, John Wick Chapter 2 has made $74.8 million here in the States and $125.8 million around the world. So John Wick Chapter 2 is still a tentative hit, but it is very, very close, less than $6 million from being a certified hit. And we'll probably hit that mark next week. But John Wick Chapter 2, despite never having been number one at the box office, is actually doing pretty well for itself. And I commend the movie for doing as well as it's doing, especially against the Lego Batman movie. And around the world, it's a certified hit. The Great Wall is a movie that's struggling mightily, at least in the United States. This weekend, it made $9.1 million. Against a budget of $150 million, it has so far made $34.8 million here in the States, which is not very good. It's not even close to a hit here. However, around the world, it's already made $301 million. I bet a bulk of that money has actually been in China. But despite how poorly it's doing in the United States, it's a certified hit around the world. So that doesn't happen very often, but a movie not being a hit in the States, but more than making up for it around the world. But sure enough, The Great Wall has done just that. 50 Shades Darker was number 2 last week. This week, it deservedly dropped to number 5, which tells you a little bit about how I felt about the movie. 50 Shades Darker made $7.8 million this weekend. Against a budget of $55 million, 50 Shades Darker has made $103.7 million here in the States and a whopping $328.6 million around the world. So 50 Shades Darker is also very much like John Wick Chapter 2, very close to becoming a certified hit here in the States. Right now it's a tentative hit, but around the world it's already certified. Fist Fight is number 6 at the box office this weekend, sliding slightly from number 5. From number 5 last week, and this weekend it made $6.6 million. Against a budget of $25 million, Fist Fight has made so far $23.4 million here in the States, and just $25 million even around the world, which means in every other country besides the United States, Fist Fight has made $1.6 million. So it's making the bulk of its money here, and it's not a hit yet here, but my guess is next week it will at least be a tentative hit, probably not a certified hit at this point. Hidden Figures is number 6 at the box office this weekend, is number 7 at the box office this weekend, falling from number 6 last week. This weekend it made $5.8 million. Against a budget of $25 million, Hidden Figures has so far made $152.7 million here in the States and $182.7 million around the world, which makes it a certified hit in both cases. La La Land, also I'm going to tell you, certified hit here in the States, around the world. Here are the numbers. This weekend it made $4.7 million. Against a budget of $30 million, it has so far made $140.9 million here in the States and $369 million around the world, which is incredible. Split is number 9 at the box office, sliding from number 7 last week. This weekend it made $4.1 million. Against a budget of $10 million, Split has made $130.8 million here in the States and $221.7 million around the world, which makes it an obvious certified hit here in the States and all around the world. And finally, Lion, number 10 at the box office. This weekend it made $3.8 million. Against a budget of $12 million, it has made $42.8 million here in the States and $88.8 million around the world, which makes it a certified hit in both cases.
You know what really gets a party started? Indoor baseball. Yeah, just find a broom or a pool cue, and you can use, like, anything as a ball. Cans, bottles, shoes.
Hey, bro, toss me that avocado.
Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, which you are listening to on bostonfreeradio.com or you are watching on Somerville Community Access TV, that is SCATV, or on Facebook Live. Either way, I'm glad you could join me to discuss my favorite topic of discussion, movies. So this is usually the part of the show where I get into my reviews, the movies I've seen this week, and letting you know what I think. But this is a special show. This is the Oscar and Razzie results show. Maybe next year I'll find out, or I'll come up with a better title for the show, but I've got a whole year to think about that. Meanwhile, it's the Oscar and Razzie results show. Take it or leave it. So, I'm going to give you just a rundown of the Oscar winners. I'm going to start with the Oscars first and then end the show with the Razzies, because for some reason I like ending the show with the worst, you know, kind of save the best for first. I guess you could call it that. So anyway, let's start with Best Picture, because there was a very interesting thing that happened on Oscar night at approximately 12:09 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And, of course, unless you've been living under a rock, you probably know what that is. But I'll just get into the Best Picture nominees and winners first. So, the nominees for Best Picture were Arrival, Fences, Hacksaw Ridge, Hell or High Water, Hidden Figures, La La Land, Lion, Manchester by the Sea, and Moonlight. So, last week on my show, my prediction for Best Picture was Moonlight. I said it was going to be a toss-up between La La Land and Moonlight, and boy, how correct I was. This is kind of me bragging, too. But so, for those of you who didn't see the clips on YouTube, what happened was Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway came out to announce the Best Picture winner. The reason those two were chosen to announce the Best Picture winners was because this year, 2017, is the 50th anniversary of the movie Bonnie and Clyde, which obviously Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway starred in, and it was the movie that made them stars. So everything kind of went according to plan. The nominees were announced, just like I announced them. And then Warren Beatty opens the envelope and he says the winner for Best Picture goes to, and you could see him looking at the award almost as if he can't read it. And at first I kind of thought to myself as I was watching it, maybe he just doesn't have his glasses. Maybe he's having a hard time reading it. Because then he gave the award, or rather the envelope to Faye Dunaway for her to read it. And so there was obviously something going on there, but when it happened, as I was watching it, I kind of thought to myself, okay, maybe he doesn't have his glasses. So Faye Dunaway announces the winner to be La La Land. And at that point, I tweeted, oh, well, I thought the Best Picture winner should have been Moonlight, but congratulations to La La Land. And then I was at the Brattle Theater watching the telecast of the Oscars, and I was getting up to get my jacket to leave, and then I heard one of the producers of La La Land, after he gave his speech, go back up to the microphone and say, wait, I'm sorry, Moonlight was the winner. And when he said that, I kind of thought he was doing the same thing that Adele did for when she won the Album of the Year at the Grammys. She was saying that Beyonce should have won for Lemonade because that was a great album. So I thought, oh, okay, maybe he's being a little modest. And then he just keeps saying, no, I mean this. Come up here. This isn't a joke. And I'm thinking, wow, he's being really gracious. Well, as it turns out, the actual winner for Best Picture, decided by the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, was Moonlight. And immediately after that, I tweeted, what? Warren Beatty read that wrong? But I'm like, who cares? My prediction was correct. Yay! So, I do think that Moonlight deserved to win Best Picture. I think it's a little bit more of an upset because a lot of people were expecting La La Land to win. But now that that fiasco kind of happened, I actually kind of feel bad for La La Land, the people who worked on that movie. At the same time, I do have to give the producers a lot of credit for being as gracious as they were for giving the award to Moonlight. Because as Jimmy Kimmel said on his show the very next night, they could have just taken the award and ran. They definitely could have done that. I would not have blamed them if they'd done that. I would have been probably a little bit mad at them, but wouldn't have blamed them for just taking off with the award, just saying, nope, you announced me first. So the question is, what happened? Was it Warren Beatty's fault? That's what a lot of people thought at first. And actually, Warren Beatty came onto the microphone after Jimmy Kimmel actually said, Warren Beatty, what have you done? But he said that the award he got, which he had a little trouble reading, was actually, when he opened the envelope, it said Emma Stone, La La Land. So Warren Beatty got the wrong envelope. Well, it turns out he wasn't kidding. So according to an article from USA Today, it turns out that that was actually the Warren Beatty getting the wrong envelope was actually a mistake of the company that the accounting firm that holds the envelopes for the Academy until the award ceremony. And that accounting firm is PricewaterhouseCoopers, which has been dealing with the Academy for all these years. I don't think this will be the end of their relationship, but I think there will be probably a stricter vetting process from here on out, especially since it would have been one thing if best sound editing had this problem happen. It would have been near the beginning of the show, and maybe there would have been a few tweets about it, but it wouldn't have been as big a deal. This was Best Picture. This was the headlining award of the night. But, you know, even though it was a fiasco, it still made some great TV. And I did think that Jimmy Kimmel had some great one-liners about it as the show was ending, and also on his show, Jimmy Kimmel Live, the next day. And I stay up to watch live shows, either Jimmy Fallon, Stephen Colbert, Jimmy Kimmel, none of those. I'm fast asleep when those shows come on. But I loved the clip of the opening monologue that Jimmy Kimmel used to open his show for last night. And I definitely recommend you watch that too. But as far as the fiasco goes with the Best Picture winner, I think lessons will be learned.
Oh, hi. Right now I'm getting a remark.
Film on Boston Free Radio, our special Oscars and Razzies show. I'm your host and movie critic Dan Burke, and of course, as I say on just about every break, Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. So on with the other winners and, well, who I think should have won that night. So I actually wrote down my Oscar picks, my predictions of who would win, sort of a mixture of who I thought will win and who I thought should win, and I'm bragging a little bit, but a lot of my predictions for the major awards, Best Picture, Best Actor, Best Actress, all the rest, actually, for the most part, were correct. Yeah, I'm bragging a little bit, but it's my show. I can do what I want. So, for actor in a leading role, as we know, the Best Actor winner was Casey Affleck for Manchester by the Sea, who I picked. Although there is some controversy with Casey Affleck winning that award, particularly because Casey Affleck has been under fire for what I believe is alleged sexual harassment and assault. I don't know all the details of these allegations. I'm not even sure if they're allegations or if they actually did happen. I don't know. But all I can say is that, putting aside those allegations, I saw Casey Affleck's performance for what it was, which was a really great performance in a really great movie, which you might remember I determined was the third best picture of 2016 in my list of top 10 best movies of the year. Yeah, Manchester by the Sea was number 3. As for the other nominees, I think if there was anyone besides Casey Affleck who would have been probably my next guess for winning, it would have been Denzel Washington for Fences. I thought Everybody who was nominated for Best Actor, I think, deserved to be there. If I were to replace anybody in terms of the nominees, I probably would have replaced Andrew Garfield in Hacksaw Ridge with Andrew Garfield in Silence, a movie that was totally underrepresented. I'm sorry, some breaking news just came on, but I'm moving on. It's not movie related. But I was surprised how much Silence was underrepresented, but that's another story for another time. For Best Actress, as we know, in a leading role, the winner, I think deservedly, was Emma Stone for La La Land. And I guess maybe I was a little too focused on the Twitter accounts and the tweets and the Facebook updates, but a lot of people are lamenting Emma Stone winning for La La Land and calling her the well-behaved Lindsay Lohan. That's a bit of a cheap shot. I think it's almost one of these deals where popularity breeds contempt, because of the five nominees listed here, Emma Stone should have won. End of story. I've always thought she was a great actress. I even thought Lindsay Lohan was a great actress before misbehaving like she is. So to call Emma Stone a well-behaved Lindsay Lohan, I don't know. It just seems like a cheap shot to put them both in the same category. I think they are put in the same category for the sole reason that they're both redheads. That's it. But anyway, moving on. For Best Actor in a Supporting Role, the person who I picked, who will win and who should win, did win. Mahershala Ali for Moonlight. And I'm really, really glad to see Mahershala Ali get the recognition he deserved. Maybe Moonlight was a bit of an underdog for Best Picture, but I think that Mahershala Ali's performance stood out amongst the other four. Dev Patel was not an actor in a supporting role. He was a lead actor. Him being in that category, that shouldn't have happened. Michael Shannon in Nocturnal Animals, I thought he was good in that role. I do think Aaron Taylor Johnson for that same movie should have been nominated instead. If there was anyone else who should have won besides Mahershala Ali, it probably could have been Lucas Hedges for Manchester by the Sea. Again, another moving performance, but Mahershala Ali was just a notch above that. So that's all I have to say about the Best Supporting Actor category. For Best Supporting Actress, another prediction of mine that came true, Viola Davis for the movie Fences. And not only did Viola Davis deserve to win amongst her counterparts, but she also gave a very moving speech, which, if you get a chance to check it out on YouTube, check it out. I've already seen the Oscars, but I'm going to check that speech out again. It was very moving. That's really all I have to say in that respect. So, moving on. Animated feature film. This was the category that A, I got wrong for predictions, and B, I do not think the movie that won deserved to win. So, just to give you a recap, well, I'll just give you the winner. The winner for animated feature film was Zootopia. And it was a good movie. It was very well animated. It had an original story. I give it credit for that. I just didn't think it was the best animated movie of the year. Let me put it to you this way. The winner, I think, should have been Kubo and the Two Strings. I think that was a movie that was underrepresented at, well, it underperformed at the box office, but the animation was amazing. I thought the story was actually even more original than Zootopia, if you believe it or not. And Zootopia, I think the bad part about Zootopia was that it felt a little preachy. But in addition to that, I think Finding Dory should have been nominated. I've said that for weeks. That's all I'm going to say about it for the rest of the time of hosting the show. I'm just going to put that to rest. So, next category, directing. The winner, who I actually predicted, again, bragging, Damien Chazelle for La La Land. And Damien Chazelle is actually made history as being the youngest director ever to win the Best Director Award. And I think he deserved it. Even though I thought Moonlight deserved Best Picture, I did think, I said before that if Damien Chazelle wins Best Director for La La Land and Best Picture goes to Moonlight, I won't be disappointed, because Best Director and Best Picture are not necessarily the same thing. But Damien Chazelle deserved this, if only for the song in the very beginning of the movie, which shows LA traffic jams with people dancing and singing to a well-choreographed song. That was all in one take, that song. That was very hard to do. And I was just very impressed that such a young director could take on such an audacious and ambitious shot like that. So, congratulations to Damien Chazelle. And me being in the Brattle Theater, people went wild because Damien Chazelle is actually a Harvard grad.
There are many sounds in your daily life. Ones that make you smile.
Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic Dan Burke, and this is our Oscars and Razzies show. And I'm continuing with my discussion about the Oscars, just the Oscars. I'll get to the Razzies later. So, best documentary feature. This is a category that always disappoints me. The reason it always disappoints me is, to date, of the 3 years I've been hosting this show, I have never seen every single documentary feature. So this is one I always get wrong. The documentary that I think should have won was 13th, which is directed by Ava DuVernay. Instead, the winner was OJ Made in America, which I will concede I have not seen it. I'm going to see it. Maybe in a later show I'll review it, but I actually haven't seen it. I actually didn't think that OJ Made in America would have been eligible because the Academy has a rule about movies that air on TV before they get released in theaters. And I assumed that because OJ Made in America was made by ESPN, their 30 for 30 features, that it wouldn't be eligible for Oscars. But I'm not at all bitter. I'm sure OJ Made in America is a really great documentary. And if it wasn't great, then it probably wouldn't have been nominated. But I've seen 3 out of the 5 documentary features that have been nominated, so that's better than last year where I saw only 1 out of the 5. And the only one that I saw actually ended up winning. That was the documentary called Amy, about Amy Winehouse. So another category I got wrong. Best documentary short subject. I sort of went with my heart on this one and said that Joe's Violin would win. But and my prediction was that because Watani, My Homeland, 4.1 Miles, and The White Helmets are about the same thing, about Syrians, I thought that the Academy would vote another way. In other words, they would not vote for the one about the Syrian refugees. But the winner is one I incorrectly predicted, but if I were to have chosen my next guess, it would have been the winner, The White Helmets. And not only am I actually happy that The White Helmets won Best Documentary Short Subject, I think The White Helmets should get the Nobel Peace Prize. I saw a feature about them on 60 Minutes before I saw the short subject documentary. And the good news is that The White Helmets is actually available for streaming on Netflix, and I highly recommend you watch it. It's deplorable what's happening in Syria, and no wonder there are Syrian refugees that Western countries are dealing with right now, including the United States. But it's really commendable what the White Helmets are doing. So I think I can't stress enough how good it is that there's an organization like the White Helmets in such a hellhole as Syria. And it's also really good that a documentary was made out of them, and fortunately, hopefully, some awareness has been raised about the White Helmets in the United States and maybe even around the world. So going on to the next category, The next category is short film live action. The one I anticipated would win, or I predicted would win, didn't actually win. So I predicted Silent Nights would win. The winner actually went to the movie Sing, which is about, it's from Hungary, and it's about a children's chorus, which is an excellent film, by the way. And one of the travesties about the short subjects is I don't think enough people can see a lot of these films. And I've been lucky enough to live in a city where I have where we have two really great independent theaters, at least two. My favorites, the Coolidge Corner Theater and the Brattle Theater, where I can see these short subjects. But I do recommend seeing Sing. I thought it was a little bit more lighthearted than the other ones, but by no means was it worse. I just thought Silent Nights probably should have won, maybe a little bit more because it had more uncontrived social commentary that fit in a really good story. But Sing also told a really good story, and it was full of a lot of surprises. Next category, Best Animated Short Film. The winner was the Disney Pixar film Piper. What I predicted would win was Borrowed Time, which was made by Pixar animators but was not released by Disney Pixar. That might change, but I thought Borrowed Time should have won. Piper was a cute story, but what really enraged me about Piper winning was that this was the short film that came before Finding Dory in theaters. So millions of Americans have seen Piper, but I'm still astonished why Finding Dory was not nominated for Best Animated Feature. I still don't know. But anyway, on to the next category. So the next category is Best Original Screenplay. And the movie I predicted would win this award was La La Land. What actually won was Manchester by the Sea. And even though I guessed it wrong, and that's going to haunt my ego for the next couple of weeks, I am glad Manchester by the Sea actually won. And the reason I'm glad is not only because it's a great movie, but because I thought people outside of New England wouldn't get Manchester by the Sea. But the fact that it won Best Original Screenplay kind of shows that there is a lot of universality in Manchester by the Sea, despite the fact that it's a very Massachusetts film. But yeah, it's great to see Manchester by the Sea get the recognition it deserved, even though the Best Actor winner was indeed controversial. Best Adapted Screenplay. I guessed that Moonlight would win. Moonlight won. And what's really great is I thought Barry Jenkins gave a great Oscar speech. And also I should note that Moonlight, which also won Best Picture, has actually made history at the Oscars. Even though Barry Jenkins did not win Best Director, he is only the third African-American director to be nominated for Best Director behind Jonathan Singleton and Lee Daniels. Surprisingly, Spike Lee and Ava DuVernay have not been nominated yet, but they might be soon. But Moonlight is the very first feature to win Best Picture that has been directed by an African American and featuring a predominantly, almost exclusively, African American cast. So obviously, Oscars So White wasn't a controversy this year as much as it was last year, but I'm really glad that Moonlight got the award deserved in spite of the fact that it made history. Birds on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. This is the Oscar and Razzie show, and I'm just about to wrap up my take on the Oscars, but there's just one last category that I predicted that I got wrong. So it was the Best Original Song category. I think Best Original Score, let me see. Best Original Score... I predicted correctly. Justin Hurwitz won for La La Land. What I didn't predict correctly was what would win Best Original Song. I guessed the right movie. I did not guess the right song. The song I thought would win was Audition, parentheses, The Fools Who Dream, which I still think was the best song in the movie. But the one that won was actually City of Lights, which was performed by John Legend at the Oscars, but was performed by Ryan Gosling in the movie. Still a good song. I think if La La Land had not won Best Original Song, there would have most definitely been a problem. Almost like 10 years ago when Dreamgirls was nominated for 3 Best Original Songs, didn't win a single one. It went to some forgettable Melissa Etheridge song in the documentary An Inconvenient Truth. Great documentary, by the way. One that has literally changed the world. But the song, not so great. So speaking of movies that are not so great, on the Oscars, now here's my take on the Razzies. For this one, I am going to read to you the list of nominees since they're not quite as well known as the Oscars. So let's start with Worst Picture. There actually are a few surprises here. For Worst Picture, the Razzie nominees are Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice, Dirty Grandpa, Gods of Egypt, Hillary's America, The Secret History of the Democratic Party, Independence Day Resurgence, and Zoolander number 2. The winner of this category was Hillary's America, The Secret History of the Democratic Party. Now, this is a docudrama. I think it's more documentary than drama, directed by controversial conservative journalist. I guess you could call him a journalist, Dinesh D'Souza. So I'm surprised it won because one of the things about the Razzies is it doesn't exactly follow the same lead as the Oscars. Over the last 20 or 30 years, Hollywood and vicariously the Oscar ceremonies have been quite liberal. When it's come to a controversial decision by Reagan, either Bush or Donald Trump, somebody has said something at the Oscars about it. I did not expect that the Razzies would get as political as they are being right now. They have nominated other films in the Razzie categories that have been politically charged documentaries like Fahrenheit 9/11, but Fahrenheit 9/11 was actually back in 2005 nominated for Worst Actor George W. Bush. So the fact that Fahrenheit 9/11 got the Razzies it did were more complimentary. And that seemed to be the exception to the rule where a prerequisite for being nominated for a Razzie is that your movie has to suck. And of course, sucking is indeed subjective, but again, Hillary's America, I can't say whether or not that is as terrible a film as the Razzies would suggest it is. I might actually check that movie out just to say that I saw it, but of the nominees here, it's the only one I haven't seen, but I'll check that out a little later. So, Worst Actor. The nominees are Ben Affleck for Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice, Gerard Butler, Gods of Egypt, and London Has Fallen, 2 movies, Henry Cavill for Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice, Robert De Niro for Dirty Grandpa, Dinesh D'Souza as himself for Hillary's America, and Ben Stiller for Zoolander number 2. So, the winner of the Worst Actor category is Dinesh D'Souza for Hillary's America. And very much like it winning Worst Picture, I can't exactly say if Hillary's America is really deserving of that award, but again, it's a movie I kind of see for myself because I'm kind of one of those moviegoers who, yes, I obviously appreciate great movies, but I have to see bad movies if only to say that I saw it and it sucked. It's kind of weird for me. Because here's my take on movies. I don't go to movies for escape. I go to movies actually as a learning experience. And if they suck, I learn why they suck. And if they're great, I learn why they're great. So I really have to put Hillary's America on my movie bucket list. Hopefully it's streaming on Netflix. But I'll let you know if and when I see that. And moving on. So worst actress, the nominees are Megan Fox, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Out of the Shadows, Tyler Perry, as Madea, which is why he's worst actress, in Boo, a Madea Halloween, Julia Roberts, Mother's Day, Becky Turner, who played Hillary Clinton in Hillary's America, Naomi Watts for two movies, Divergent Series Allegiant and Shut-In, and Shailene Woodley for Divergent Series Allegiant. And did I say Divergent? I'm sorry. Allegiant. That's, well, goes to show you what I thought of that movie. I actually haven't seen it. So the winner of the worst actor category, actress category, is Becky Turner as Hillary Clinton. Again, I can't comment on it. I will say, however, that 2 years ago, Megan Fox deservedly won Worst Actress for the original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie, or at least the Michael Bay-produced one from 2014. It's a shame she didn't, quote-unquote, win this year, because Megan Fox sucks. At least she's an overrated actress. I guess that's really all I have to say about it, but I'm curious now that I know an actress played Hillary Clinton in the movie Hillary's America. So I'm going to see that movie, and I will definitely let you know what I think. And I'm getting some comments on Facebook right now saying that Allegiant was actually a good movie. That's probably the first comment I've heard about Allegiant being a good movie, but I really can't say. I haven't seen any of the Divergent movies, so I'm just going to remain mum on this one. So I only have time to read the Worst Supporting Actress nominees, and they are Julianne Hough for Dirty Grandpa, Kate Hudson, Mother's Day, Aubrey Plaza, Dirty Grandpa, Jane Seymour, 50 Shades of Black, Cella Ward, Independence Day Resurgence, and Kristen Wiig, Zoolander.
I love those real sick sons. They're the ones that
on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, and this is the Oscar and Razzie review show, which doesn't have an official title, which is why you could kind of hear me saying it off the top of my head. So I announced the Worst Supporting Actress nominees in the Razzies, and the winner for Worst Supporting Actress is Kristen Wiig for Zoolander number 2. I probably, yeah, all the actresses were bad in their respective movies. I would probably say, if I were to have chosen a winner, I would have chosen Julianne Hough for Dirty Grandpa, just because Dirty Grandpa was just not a particularly good movie. I thought it tried way too hard, and Julianne Hough kind of fell into the trap that a lot of wedding movies fall into, in that, or a lot of modern wedding movies, one of the biggest cliches of modern wedding movies is that the bride-to-be is a bitch. Try saying that 5 times fast. No, don't really. Especially if you're at work. But anyway, I vaguely remember Kristen Wiig in Zoolander number 2. I guess her performance didn't have that much of an impression on me, but, well, she's been better in other films, and I think that's the important part. So now, worst supporting actor. The nominees are Nicolas Cage, Snowden, Johnny Depp, Alice Through the Looking Glass, Will Ferrell, Zoolander number 2, Jesse Eisenberg, Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice, Jared Leto for Suicide Squad, and Owen Wilson, Zoolander number 2. Now, the winner of this category, I actually do take issue with. The winner for Worst Supporting Actor was Jesse Eisenberg for Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice. I don't think this is deserved, because I said when I originally reviewed Batman vs. Superman, first of all, I acknowledge it was not a perfect film. There were elements about it that didn't make it great. I still didn't think it was terrible, but I did actually like Jesse Eisenberg as Lex Luthor. I thought that bringing another approach to Lex Luthor, not making him, you know, necessarily bald or, you know, strapping or stoic, was an interesting move. I thought making Lex Luthor almost kind of a millennial computer genius was a nice touch, but I do acknowledge that maybe Jesse Eisenberg's performance was a little high strung, but I didn't think it was terrible. If any person were to have won this category instead, and I do put one in quotes, I think it probably would have been Johnny Depp for Alice Through the Looking Glass. But to Johnny Depp's credit, Alice in Wonderland Through the Looking Glass was not bad solely because of him. It was bad because the story deviated entirely from Lewis Carroll's book of the same name, and also it focused way too much on the Mad Hatter. And the only reason that it focused on the Mad Hatter was because the biggest movie star in the movie was cast as the Mad Hatter. And that really didn't do justice for the movie. So I still attest Johnny Depp should have won instead of Jesse Eisenberg. I did say when I was reviewing Batman vs. Superman that Henry Cavill was the best actor to play Superman so far on the big screen. I retract that statement. The best is still Christopher Reeve. If you disagree, leave me a comment, but that's my story and I'm sticking to it. So, worst screen combo. The nominees are Ben Affleck and his BFF, that is baddest foe forever, Henry Cavill for Batman vs. Superman, any two Egyptian gods or mortals in Gods of Egypt, Johnny Depp and his vomitously vibrant costume in Alice Through the Looking Glass. I'm reading this as I'm going along, so that one took me by surprise. The entire cast of once-respected actors for Collateral Beauty, Tyler Perry and that same old worn-out wig, Boo a Madea Halloween, and Ben Stiller and his BFF, this time meaning barely funny friend, Owen Wilson, for Zoolander number 2. The winner of this category is Ben Affleck and Henry Cavill for Batman vs. Superman, which, man, this was up against some really tough competition, to be honest with you, because I would have either chosen any two Egyptian gods or mortals in Gods of Egypt or Tyler Perry in that same old worn-out wig for Boo and Madea Halloween, because I initially thought that I didn't like the Madea movies because I'm white, and because I assumed black people would get this humor more than I would. I've heard black people that I know personally slam Tyler Perry movies, and I thought, thank God, it's not just because I'm white. And I've said it before, and I'll say it again, Madea must die. Moving on. Worst director. The nominees are Dinesh D'Souza and Bruce Shuley for Hillary's America, The Secret History of the Democratic Party, Roland Emmerich for Independence Day Resurgence, Tyler Perry for Boo, a Madea Halloween, Alex Proyas for Gods of Egypt, Zack Snyder for Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice, and Ben Stiller for Zoolander number 2. This is Worst Director, remember. The winner for Worst Director is Dinesh D'Souza and Bruce Shuley for Hillary's America. I don't even know if Dinesh D'Souza showed up to the Razzies, but if he did, he would have gained a lot of credibility in my book, because it would have at least showed a little bit of grace on his part. But I don't think Dinesh D'Souza is known for being gracious. But anyway, I really can't say if Hillary's America was deserving of this award, because of the six movies that were nominated, again, Hillary's America is the only one I haven't seen. So moving on to worst prequel, remake, ripoff, or sequel. All together in one category. The nominees are Avatar: The Looking Glass, Batman vs. Superman: Dawn of Justice, 50 Shades of Black, Independence Day Resurgence, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles: Out of the Shadows, and Zoolander number 2. The winner of this category is Batman vs. Superman: Dawn of Justice. I think 50 Shades of Black should have won, because that was my choice for worst movie of the year. And I guess that's really all I have to say before the next break. Segway.
Allison is perfect.
On film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. This is the Oscar and Razzie Review Show. I'm going to get a more clever name for that, I swear to you. But just a note about the promo I played before this, Toppers with Gil. That's a show that's coming up next at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time right here on Boston Free Radio, and I recommend you check it out. Gil is a little weird. That's not an insult to him. He's delightfully weird. I think the Webster's dictionary word would be quirkical. I think that's a word that best describes Gil, but I still enjoy listening to his show because he has a very eclectic mix of songs. So if you can, stay tuned for Toppers with Gil. It's at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time next on Boston Free Radio. On to the last category for the Razzies, which I haven't covered, worst screenplay. The nominees are Batman vs. Superman: Dawn of Justice, Dirty Grandpa, Gods of Egypt, Hillary's America: The Secret History of the Democratic Party, Independence Day Resurgence, and Suicide Squad. I do have to say that worst screenplay might not entirely be necessary for the Razzies. It's obviously necessary for the Oscars. For the Razzies, I don't know. If a movie is determined to be worst picture, or even considered to be worst picture, I think that should be enough, not just how it's worded. But then again, I could be wrong. But the winner for the worst screenplay category is Batman vs. Superman: Dawn of Justice, which I think it deserved to be worst screenplay. I do think that the main weakness of Batman vs. Superman was that they threw a lot at you in terms of story. There were a lot of subplots in there. And also, it showed that they were in a really big hurry to get the Justice League movie underway. What they should have done was they should have made the Wonder Woman movie first and then come out with Batman vs. Superman. But in a country where we nominated our first woman to be presidential candidate for a major party, but then didn't vote for her, it's kind of no wonder that Batman vs. Superman was made first, because apparently a lot of people don't trust the idea of a female superhero or even a female villain. And what I'm talking about here is with Suicide Squad, a movie about Harley Quinn should have been made first, especially considering that one of the strengths of Suicide Squad, undeniably, was the fact that Margot Robbie was great as Harley Quinn. I absolutely loved her in that role. For that reason, I thought Suicide Squad was a commendable movie and shouldn't have been nominated for worst screenplay. Again, it was a little messy in terms of story, but all the more reason for a Harley Quinn movie to probably should have been made first, but hopefully they make one now. So there's just one last category in the Razzies, and this one is the Razzie Redeemer Award. And this is an award that goes to somebody who has made bad movies in the past, but actually kind of came back with a good movie this year. So some previous nominees for Razzie Redeemer, and I think I'm talking about last year, or maybe 2 years ago, was Jennifer Aniston, who has made rom-com after rom-com, but was actually nominated for the Razzie Redeemer Award for her stirring performance in the movie Cake. Also, Mike Myers, who was nominated previously for his career-killing movie The Love Guru, but then was nominated for a Razzie Redeemer Award for directing a fascinating documentary, Supermensch, which I should review on this show a little later on. Maybe I'll dedicate a whole show to documentaries, but that's for another time. But the Razzie Redeemer Award this year went to veteran actor and director Mel Gibson. Now, a lot of people who are millennials, who are younger millennials, don't remember this, but about 20 years ago, actually exactly 20 years ago, Mel Gibson was as big a name as George Clooney is today, and he has taken a hard fall from grace, deservedly, after that drunken anti-Semitic rant he made, which, of course, I can't even dignify or condone. He deserved that fall from grace, but he's come back this year with Hacksaw Ridge, and I actually think that he can direct a better movie than Hacksaw Ridge, and he will direct a better movie than Hacksaw Ridge later on. Is he ready to be the A-list star he used to be? That has yet to be seen.